Good morning, and welcome to our worship service today. Starting March 2nd, we will engage in a church-wide prayer initiative for the Cove. The Book of Acts records the history of the early church and the challenges they faced. They met this challenge with a heavy reliance on corporate prayer. We too face challenging times today. The church is called to meet these challenges through the powerful tool of corporate prayer. You will have the opportunity to join in this battle by participating in a 40-day prayer focus. Join me in committing to praying for our community by stopping by the table in the lobby, signing the commitment form, and picking up your copy of Seek God for the Cove. The Martinsburg Ministerium of Churches will be hosting a free skating party on Saturday, March 19th from 1 to 3 at the park. This is open to everyone.
As Pastor Brian mentioned last week, later this spring, we'll be doing a church-wide emphasis on the gospel. This will include Sunday sermons, ABFs, youth and kids ministries, and life groups. This will also include Forged and Refined, a 5-week discipleship plan designed to build relationships within the church family. Whether you've been here for years or you're brand new, this is a great opportunity to connect. This week, take a few minutes to check out the Forged and Refined page on the church website to get a feel for what this round looks like. Talk to some friends about joining you. Or if you'd like to join but don't have a group, our men's and women's ministries will help you get connected with others in the church. Registration will open March 6th.
You have 1 week left to sign up for the Pinewood Derby and the Open Derby. The registration deadline is next Sunday, so be sure to stop at the table in the lobby if you haven't done that yet. There are two derbies that you can participate in. Kids in grades kindergarten through 5 would participate in the Pinewood Derby. And there are some very specific directions that you have to follow when making your car, so please make sure you pick up the information at the table. The Open Derby is for anyone older than 6th grade, or if you're a family with younger kids and you'd like to participate as a family, you can do that as well. There are very few restrictions in the Open Derby, and you can make your car out of whatever you'd like and be as creative as you want to. So please stop by the table in the lobby. If you have any questions about either derby race, get in touch with me. Again, you have 1 week left to register.
Thanks for worshiping with us this morning. To keep pace with all of the events and ministries of MGBC, go to mgbconline.com.
Good morning, everybody. Let's try that again. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
So much better. Thanks for joining us in person. Thanks for joining us online. If you're in person, we'd like to invite you to stand as we read our call to worship together. This morning we'll be reading from Mark chapter 12. Let's read. Jesus answered, "The most important is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. The second is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these." Let's sing.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior.
Well, we want to welcome all of you here today. It's good to see you. Some of our folks are at the marriage retreat at Roxbury, and they're having a good time down there as well. We want to thank everyone who's joining as well online with us this morning. And this is kind of earth-shattering, but we really have no other announcements. So I think that might be the first that's ever happened in the history of our church. So I guess I should tell you that I'm leaving for Turkey on Tuesday evening, the country of Turkey. So I'd appreciate prayer.
That's a good distinction. So,
yeah.
Leaving
yeah.
for turkey dinner.
So, and we had a big turkey dinner the other night. So I don't know. My mom just decided she was hungry for turkey. So I don't know if it was a subliminal message or what. But we're going to go see where the seven churches of Revelation are. And we'll be doing an elective series. Some classes are combining in May, in June. And we'll have a special class I'll be able to teach when I get back. So I'm really excited. And I'm going with Dr. Randy Smith, who has been here before, but just pray for us. There's several from the district going as well, so that's just really going to be a good time. I know that there are several people hurting right now in our church, so let's go to prayer and just pray, and I'm sure we won't remember everyone here today, but just for anybody that you're thinking about, be praying for them during this time as well. Dear Lord, we do go to prayer right now for those who are really hurting and struggling. We especially think of the Eugene Smith family as Eugene has been ushered into your presence this week. And there's a bittersweet aspect to this. They grieve because he has gone, but they celebrate because he has been struggling for some time, and now he is in glory with his loved ones, with his faithful dad and others who have gone before his mom. And just, I always think about that when our loved ones pass, they get to see loved ones whom they haven't been with for so long. So thank you for the hope of heaven and for the way you are working. We pray also for those who are really struggling and hurting physically right now or have been going through some tough times. But, you know, we think of Dale Longenecker just dealing with COVID pneumonia. We also we want to pray as well for Grace Phillips and Phyllis Keim and Betty Stern. And there are others on the prayer sheet as well, that we just pray for their health and pray for their well-being, that they can be encouraged. We pray for anyone here in the sanctuary and also listening online that who might be struggling with a physical struggle or maybe emotionally they're struggling, dealing with just something in their life that's been heavy. We pray that you would encourage them and heal their heart and allow them to trust you. We do thank you so much for this opportunity to worship you. We know this world is hurting, and there's a lot of things going on right now. We think of our fellow believers in the Ukraine, Christians that know you, that have the threat of war. We pray that you will heal that situation as well, that you could intervene and move in individuals not to proceed. We know that whatever happens is according to your will, and you allow this sin-cursed world to have the ramifications of our sin and choices. And sometimes you stand back and allow things to happen for that grander purpose that only you know. So we trust you and we worship you. We praise you because you are so good to us. So in the midst of the struggle, we have a lot to be thankful for and grateful for as we worship you today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand and sing together.
Needless pain we bear.
to the Lord in prayer. And griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, 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 oh. Everybody has trials and temptations. Everybody knows heartbreak, isolation. But we can lay our burdens down. Lay our burdens down. What a friend we have in Jesus. East to west, my sins are gone. I see grace on every horizon. And forever and ever, His heart is my home. Everybody has fears. Everybody got worries. Everybody knows sorrow, devastation. Ooh, ooh, ooh. We can lay our burdens down. Lay our burdens down. What a friend we have in Jesus. East to west, my sins are gone. I see grace on every horizon. And forever and ever, His heart is my home. No more betrayal, for He is faithful. He fills me up and my cup runneth over. No more betrayal, for He is faithful. How He is proving it over and over. No more betrayal, for He is faithful. He fills me up and my cup runneth over. No more betrayal, for He is faithful. How He is proving it over and over. Over and over. Jesus, east to west, my sins are gone. I see grace on every horizon, and forever and ever, his heart is my home. What a friend we have in Jesus, east to west, my sins are gone. I see grace on every horizon, and forever and ever, his heart is my home. Forever and ever, his heart is my home.
Jesus, we see a perfect example of a friend, and some thoughts from those two previous songs. We can take anything to him. He knows our weakness, yet despite knowing everything about us, he's faithful and he won't betray us. I love that line. There's no betrayal. And I know all those things are true, personally. I know it, but I still fall short in my relationship with Jesus all the time. And I just keep living on my own strength. They're trying to. It's like, hey, Jesus, I know you literally conquered death when you rose from the grave, but my issues are too much to bother you, so I'm not going to bother you with that. That's crazy when you think of it like that, right? The verse that we've looked at the past couple weeks already in our series, John 15:13, says, greater love has no one than this, that someone laid down his life for his friends. And Jesus did just that. He laid down his life for his friends. Not only that, but he rose again. He offers us eternal life with him. And that life with Jesus starts right now. We don't have to wait to live life with Jesus whenever we go to meet him face to face. But that life with Jesus is offered right now. And when we get to sing, we have a unique opportunity to express our love for Jesus collectively. So we're taking these prayers that are written, poetry essentially, but they're prayers put to melodies so that we can pray them together. How awesome is that? We get to do that every week whenever we gather together. So as we continue to sing, I want to encourage you to let these words be a prayer from your heart and a reminder to your heart of the faithfulness of our God. Let's sing.
It's running after me.
You are so good to us. You have been good all of our lives, even through our difficult times. You've been that anchor, someone we can hang on to when life doesn't make sense. Thank you for your friendship, that you want to be our friend, and that you challenge us to be friends to others. Sometimes we need people in the flesh to be there, to encourage, to support us, to give us a hug, to cheer us on. And so you use your people, God's people, to be friends with others. Thank you for how you've designed relationship and that the Trinity is in relationship with one another and that you've allowed us to be invited in to that relationship through the person of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Life is good because we have hope, because we have a Savior, because we know that you will lead us through. Thank you for being our friend. And as we're challenged today through the nuts and bolts of how to be a good friend, just challenge us to make that a priority in our lives. It's easy to get distracted and neglect relationships. So we thank you for this time in your word. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. It is now time for the kids to head to children's worship. The elementary kids will go with Miss Jerry on this side, and the preschool kids will go with Sarah on this side. So have a good time. Well, today we continue our series on friends. We need friends in our lives. We aren't meant to be alone. We need each other. We can't be an island to ourselves. But most importantly, we need to be friends of God. As we talked about 2 weeks ago, we need to be friends of God, and He wants to have a friendship with us. And then Pastor Brian last week unpacked the idea of the Trinity in friendship, in relationship with us as well, and that we were challenged to serve others. That's one way that we can be friends to other Christians, by serving others. And then also, we learned about the golden rule, how Jesus gave us something very simple to understand that we need to do in our lives, and that is that we need to do unto others as we would like to be treated. If we want to be treated nice, we need to be nice to other people. We're kind of losing that in our society today. Of course, it's a biblical principle, so we need to follow what this book says because it helps us to be joyful in life and to walk a good path. And helps us to be a friend of God, but to be friends of others. So today we will look at some of those basic principles on how to be a friend. And as we were working through this study, we worked together as a pastoral staff on this as we plan out our series and so forth. And this was the week where Pastor Brian came to me and said, I'd like you to use Rick Warren's material on this, on how to unpack friends. And I feel extremely guilty that I cheated this week and used all of his material. I've reprogrammed it and made it my own. But I'm going to say that right up front so that if you say, wait, Pastor Brandt, use Rick Warren's stuff on this, you'll know. Sometimes we do take some liberties with that. So we give them credit. As Pastor Brian always says, there's nothing new under the sun. So I'm so thankful for Pastor Rick Warren, and he's just very practical in his approach, and yet also loves the Word of God as well. So I just want to say that right up front, and then I'll throw in some of my own things as well. But There's five reasons biblically why we need to have friends, according to Rick Warren. And he says this: we need friends to help us to grow spiritually. We need friends to grow spiritually. Romans 1:12 says, we are to mutually encourage one another in faith. We have an obligation to encourage other people spiritually. This is why we need friends. We cannot grow by ourselves. There are people that think they can just go be by themselves and grow spiritually, or they can just go out on their boat on Sunday morning and just go do that and worship God there. The problem is, the Bible says you are supposed to be in relationship with others. We need to have corporate worship together. And I may tramp on some toes, but and I understand sometimes you can't be here, people are sick, sometimes you're on vacation. It's awesome, the technology that we have, that we can watch the service online. But if that's become your pattern and you're never in fellowship with other believers, you are missing a huge element in your spiritual life. We need to be together. In our society, we have lost something in the last 2 years of just being together with people, and we've pulled back, and we have this resistance to maybe shake hands or to approach people, and it's, you know, it's what we've had to do, but it's really unfortunate. We need to be in relationship with each other, and especially that's the case for our spiritual growth. You know, a plant needs certain things in order to grow and thrive. It needs sunlight, it needs water, it needs the soil, it needs the food of the soil, it needs fertilizer, it needs to be protected from pests that can eat the plant and kill the plant. We also need that as well. In order to grow spiritually, we need certain things, and we need friends to encourage us spiritually. And let me say it this way: Jesus needed his friends. And even when Jesus was away from his disciples, whom he spent time with, he was friends with them, and he poured his life into them. But when he pulls away, we kind of get this idea that's when he was really spiritual, when he was alone. But he actually wasn't alone. He pulled away from other human beings to be in friendship with his Father, with God. So we do need times when we pull away from others, but we have this communion with God. We're friends of God, and we need to hear him speak to us. So that's an important aspect as well. We can't just be an island to ourselves. We need each other, and we need God pouring himself into us so that we grow spiritually. And then this leads to the next point. We need friends for emotional support. We need friends for emotional support. Did you know that there are 58 one another commands in Scripture? We have done series on this. We have talked about the one another's a lot over the years because there's so many of them in Scripture. We're going to be sharing a lot of them today. We need to love one another. This is not in my notes, but it just came to me. But I did say to our staff, the pastors, as we were meeting a couple months ago, I said, we did that one another series like at the beginning of the pandemic. I think we need to do that again. Ouch. And I need to do that again personally. We have lost the one another's in the church. Are we loving one another? Are we honoring one another? Are we encouraging one another? Are we serving one another? Are we praying for one another? Are we supporting one another? Are we mutually building one another up as friends? It is so important that we do that, because people need emotional support. There has been more fallout because of this time in our lives emotionally. People are hurting bad. Do you know it takes months for people to get a counselor now? We have very few professional counselors in our area, and we have our counseling center in East Freedom, which has been wonderful, that Pastor Brian had vision for, and Luella Stern is our counselor there in the counseling center. And so that is wonderful. There's just not enough counselors to support all of the people. And when I've been aware of situations in State College where counselors are backed up 4 to 5 months. So if someone is going through a big time thing and they have to wait 5 months to get a counselor, can you imagine the ramifications of that? That's why we need each other. When we're in relationship with others and we can encourage each other when we're down and we're discouraged and we need that shoulder to cry on, and we need a hug and we need that encouragement, then we won't need to go to a counselor. I mean, we do need counselors for the bigger things, for sure. But we need friends in our lives, and we need to be the ones reaching out, giving that emotional support. Galatians 6:2 gives another one of those one another's. Bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. We are to confess our sins one to another and bear one another's burdens. That helps us in our walk. When we're struggling with sin, our friends can help us and challenge us and help us keep on the right path. We cannot be an island to ourselves. We need each other. For a third point, we need friends for good health. Now, this one really intrigued me because I hadn't really thought of this before. But Rick Warren points out that in James 5:16, it says this, "Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another, and look at the result, that you may be healed." The context of this passage is for those who are really sick and hurting, and they can go to the elders, and the elders can pray over them and give them that encouragement so that they might be healed physically, but more importantly, spiritually. If people are hurting spiritually, we need to go and make sure we're right with God, and we have one another to bear those burdens so we can be healed through friendships. Isn't that a wonderful thing, that we have others that can help us to grow, and so that we can live a full life and that we can be encouraged? Friends provide that encouragement that we need. We also need friends for social enjoyment as well, for fun. Now, I don't know, is that a spiritual thing? We kind of get this idea that, well, we can't have fun in the church. You know, you can't joke around too much because it gets too far over the top. But didn't God create humor? Didn't he create for us to have enjoyment in life? This life should not be boring. We should have fun with one another. And we do that through friendships. And some of our friends are brutal. I had brutal friendships. I have always been the one picked on. My family loves to pick on me about everything. I'm the one that gets all the brunt of all the jokes. And I've embraced it. And my dad was, he loved to joke. He loved to pull practical jokes all the time. And so I've just kind of embraced that. It's kind of a fun thing to know that if people are laughing at your expense, that's a good thing. It's not a bad thing. It's good that people laugh. But in college, I had some brutal friends. We had this midnight breakfast the night before finals, and I always had a 7:30 final on Tuesday morning. But you go to this breakfast at midnight. It's like, I should be in bed. I have this final. And it became a tradition to hide my bed somewhere on campus. So the one time it was at the entrance of the school underneath the flagpole. One time I hid my own bed in the closet in the dorm so they couldn't find it, but somehow they found it and still hid it. And this was like, and then I'm like, wait, God, it's 2:00 in the morning. I have a final in the morning. I need to get to bed. And then, of course, your friends, well, that's your problem. You have to put your bed back. And we did these baptisms too. And this sounds very unspiritual for a Bible college, but the friends would decide that so and so needs a baptism. So they would go grab them wherever they were and throw them under the faucet outside the dorm. And you get drenched. And I don't know, I got baptized. I've been baptized many times. So much for the three dips in the Grace Brethren Church. You know, we need to have friends. And this is stuff I still remember and I laugh about. And as I shared, I lost my best friend from college this past summer. And it was tough. I hadn't been around him for a while. And I was just surprised how it affected me. It took a long time to process the emotions of that. And knowing that he's in heaven is just a wonderful peace. But it's hard when we lose friends. We need to cherish the time that we have, and we need to have good laughs together, good belly laughs together. When was the last time you had a belly laugh? We need to laugh and enjoy one's company. And if you're in an environment where you never laugh and you can't have fun, oh my. You need to find some friends that can help you laugh, because we need each other. Genesis 2:18 says, "Then the Lord said, 'It is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him.'" And we shared that 2 weeks ago in the message. And then Ecclesiastes 3:12 and 13 says this, "I perceive that there is nothing better for them than to be joyful and to do good as long as they live. Also that everyone should eat and drink and take pleasure in all of his toil. This is God's gift to man. Let me sum it up. You can't work all the time. You need to have some fun in life. You need to go on vacation. You need to spend time with friends, enjoying one another. That's part of this life that we live. We need each other. We also need friends to help us reach our life goals. We need our friends to help us reach our life goals. Ecclesiastes 4:9 says, it's better to have two than one. We need each other. We need each other. We're part of a team. We accomplish more together than apart. That's why we need our church family. We need each one of us working together to encourage one another. We can't do this life alone. It's too hard. We need one another. Ephesians 4:16, which was the theme verse when we built this building back in 1996. This was our theme verse for this building project, and it was this. The whole body, the church, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, when each part is working properly, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. That verse had nothing to do with this building. It had everything to do with you, the church, so that we had a place where we could all gather to worship, because we were out of our small worship center over there, and we needed a bigger place. But it wasn't about the building. It was about us being together as a church family to encourage one another, to build each other up in love. Cooper Kupp is a follower of Christ, as many of you may be aware. He was named the offensive player. And speaking of friends, we do have a really good time in the office. We laugh a lot. I kid around that I like Mondays because on Mondays, Pastor Brian, Pastor Ryan, and Pastor Daryl are off, and it's really quiet in the office on Mondays. So I get a lot done on Mondays, but it's kind of boring. And then Daryl sneaks in sometimes on Mondays. I'm like, why are you here? You're supposed to be off. And then somehow we're laughing, and he brings a lightness to us. And of course, you know Daryl and just his personality. So, oh, there you are. You moved. You are in here. I'm in big trouble now. Okay. So we need each other. We need our friends, and we need Daryl. We need Daryl for laughs. Well, anyhow, I have no idea now where I'm at. Oh, yes, Cooper Kupp. That's where I'm at. He was the MVP for the Super Bowl last Sunday, and many of you saw his performance, how he helped his team overcome the odds there and come from behind, and he won. He was named to the Pro Bowl. He has just been amazing this season, really has broken out, and he has become a star and now has the Super Bowl trophy. But it was really interesting watching his interview at the end of the Super Bowl when he's being presented the trophy. Now, some of it might have been camera angle, but to me, it seemed interesting that his hat was tilted down and you couldn't really see his face very well. And he just seemed to have this humble demeanor about him, which was so wonderful. He wasn't bragging and just, but this is what he said. I don't feel deserving of this. God is just so good. I'm just so thankful for the guys I get to be around, his team, for the coaches, for my family. You know, Cooper Kupp could not have performed and become the Super Bowl MVP. He could not have gotten all the awards he got this year if he hadn't worked with his team. He hadn't been friends with his team. The best teams, you always hear about it. You hear about how the offensive line and the quarterback, they go out to dinner together and they're friends. And the teams that have animosity, they just don't work as well. We need to work together as friends and we'll be able to accomplish much. Someone has said success in the job is 85% of the time being good at relational skills and 15% actually doing the job. Most people get fired because they're not good at relationships. It's not because they mess up. Because if you're good at relationships, they'll probably forgive you when you mess up and help you through it. But people that don't do well in their jobs is because they lack social skills, relationship ability. It's vital that we know how to be good friends to others. These are biblical principles that apply so well in life. Well, we've seen the importance of good friendships, and we've also had fun picking on Daryl for a little bit here as well this morning. So now I want to transition and go into another part here, and that is giving you some nuts and bolts to friendships. And I'm going to use the T word, just T words to help you remember and help you think this through. So first off, in order to be a good friend, you need to spend time. This is one that we cannot shortcut. In order to have friendships, you have to spend time with people. You have to make the effort. And when you don't spend time with others, you're not going to have good friendships. You're not going to have good relationships. It's absolutely important that we spend time together. We need to regularly touch base with people. We need to hang out with them, talk with them, listen to them, laugh together. And we do that by spending time together. Romans 12:15 says, "Rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep." Rejoice with those who rejoice. Celebrate, have fun, and encourage one another whenever there's good times, and then weep with those who weep. Weep whenever your friends are hurting or struggling or going through a difficult time or get a cancer diagnosis or need that prayer or if they've lost a loved one, weep with those who weep. But it takes time in order to do that. Next, we need to trust our friendships. We need to trust our friends. We need to be trustful. We need to be reliable and loyal. Proverbs 17:17 says, "A friend loves at all times." A friend loves at all times. Also, Proverbs 11:13 says, "Whoever goes about slandering reveals secrets, but he who is trustworthy in spirit keeps things covered." True friends share things, but don't break confidences. You can trust them that they're going to keep it. And you can also trust that if you share something with them that's pretty big, that you know they're not going to bail on you, that they're going to be there and they're going to help you through whatever you're struggling with. Friends should provide good advice and counsel. We need that in our lives. Proverbs 27:9 says, "Oil and perfume make the heart glad, and the sweetness of a friend comes from his earnest counsel." Provide your friends with good biblical counsel. I have to get on a soapbox for just a little bit. This is something that really eats me up as a pastor, because I've seen it happen so many times. But people will put things on Facebook, social media, about a relationship that they're dealing with, either it's their spouse or a boyfriend, girlfriend, or just a friend or whatever, and they'll go on there and they'll just trash the other person on social media. Now that's bad enough, but what I really hate is when people, their so-called friends, or they go to work and they start talking about what's happening to their friends, and their friends start confirming everything that they're saying. Because they think they're a good friend by telling them, "Oh yeah, he's a jerk, she's a jerk, you need to get rid of them, you need to ditch them, you need to get rid of them in your life." And it's like, wait a minute. That's only one side of the story. Don't have friends who are going to tell you to do things against what the Bible says. It happens all the time. Don't just listen to random friends. Make sure that you know what they say is biblical. That's why we need friends who follow this book, who give you good counsel, who won't pull the punches. They will let you know when you're wrong and tell you you aren't thinking correctly. You don't have a balanced perspective right now. You're being very self-centered. There's so much bad counsel out there, and it really bugs me. It really bugs me when I see that. And then we who see it assume that everything you read on social media is correct. And the other person who's defenseless is back here. Yeah, they're probably not perfect. There's probably issues there. But they have no way of saying what the truth really is, no way of defending themselves. And it has become a super cancer in our society. And might I say, it can even be a cancer in our church. So please, whatever you get out of this message, find friends who you can trust, but who will also be truthful and biblical in their counsel to you. Because that will make your life so much better It will make your life so much better. We need friends who are like that, who are faithful, that we can trust. And then we need friends, we need to tune into our friends. We need to tune into our friends. We need to listen to our friends. We need to be empathetic and caring, as we've already talked about. And men, we really need to work on this one because it's hard, and it's hard for me. I am a one-tracker big time, and sometimes people can talk to me, and I'm hearing them, but I'm not listening. And can you relate to that? We need friends that can listen to us and really get what we're saying. And we need friends to call us out on that, too, or family members that they do. They call me out, and I've had people say, you're not listening, or you didn't hear me, or you didn't get what I said. So we need that, too, in order to tune in and really get what the other person is saying. James 1:19 says this, know this, my beloved brothers, let every person or friend be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. Let every friend be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. Then we also need to tolerate our friends, and this is a difficult topic because there's an aspect of biblical tolerance, and then there's the way the world defines tolerance, which isn't biblical. But we need to accept the flaws and idiosyncrasies of our friends, the things that might grate us a little bit or the things that might be are just different. We need to accept those. We need to help our friends overcome their sins and shortcomings. That means we accept them even if they're struggling through sin. That doesn't mean, though, that we tolerate it and just sweep that sin under the carpet and say it doesn't matter or give them bad counsel. It means that we help them walk through that and grow and become better in their walk with Christ. That's true biblical tolerance. Romans 15:7 says, therefore, welcome one another as Christ welcomed you for the glory of God. There's another one of those one another's. We welcome each other. But Proverbs 27:5 is also in the scripture. It says this, better is open rebuke than hidden love. Faithful are the wounds of a friend. Profuse are the kisses of an enemy. We need friends who aren't going to just hold back. We need friends who are going to be honest and truthful with us to help us. And yet they tolerate us and deal with us as well and love us through those things. Finally, we need friends that we can thrive together with. Pick friends who make you thrive, who make you better, not worse. And be a friend that makes your friend better, not worse. Be a good influence on your friends. Proverbs 27:17 says, iron sharpens iron. You know the verse, but it's so true. We need to encourage one another and help people thrive in their life. Rick Warren provided a list of practical ways you can be a friend, a good Christian friend. And I just want to share this list with you just to encourage you to be thinking about these things. And you might want to take a picture of that list. We have the notes in the YouVersion Bible app that you can download it there to get this. But be thinking about these things. And maybe think about the areas where maybe you struggle more that you need to work on. But here, this is just a really good challenge for us. Christian friends nourish your spirit. They nudge you to grow. They push and prod you to become what you could become. They help you see the humor in difficulties. They enlarge your perspective in your narrow vision. They help you stand in the fire. Boy, when life's rough and it's burning all around you, you need someone to help you walk through it. They help you get unstuck and pull you out of a rut. They recharge and revitalize your battery when you feel drained. Boy, do we need our batteries recharged. And we can do that. And that's part of the humor thing and just having fun together. We need to be recharged. We need to they encourage you when you're discouraged. They provide a shoulder to cry on when you're hurting. They share your burdens. They lift your mood. They make you feel better. They help you face the unknown. And they definitely encourage you to trust God more. If you have a friend who doesn't encourage you spiritually, they really can't be a true, deep friend if you're a Christian. We've got to have good Christians good friends who help us spiritually. So I just want to share some practical things as we prepare to close. First off, you can check out a 10-day devotional that I happened to stumble across. This material was taken from Rick Warren in a video series that he had provided, but there's actually a 10-day Bible study on how to build great relationships. If you go to the YouVersion Bible app that many of you use, you can download this devotional for the next 10 days that will provide you scriptures that you can read each day about how to build better relationships and friendships. So I encourage you to download that and go through that, especially if this is an area where you're struggling. Also, as Ryan comes forward to lead in our closing song, I want to give some practical suggestions. And we're going to be done a little earlier today. So I would encourage some of you that like to run off real quick and leave. Maybe you need to stay and search out a friend that you haven't talked to for a while here in the church. Maybe there's someone, maybe you sit up in the balcony and there's someone down here you haven't talked to for a while. Maybe you need to come down. Maybe you down here need to go up there or go across. But is there a friend that you haven't reached out to? Maybe there's a friend outside of this room, another good Christian friend, or maybe a friend who's not a believer that you would love to see become a believer, but you need to spend some time with them this week and renew that friendship. Here's just some practical suggestions on how to do that. It seems so basic, but we struggle with these things because we're so busy. But text or phone or FaceTime a friend that you haven't seen for a while. Write a note of encouragement. It takes some effort to write notes or cards. It's kind of a lost art today. But do that, possibly. Do something tangible for your friend. Help them out or take them to a meal this week. Here's a good one if you like to be outside. Or maybe if you don't like to be outside, do it anyhow because it's good for you. I'm being very confrontive today. I didn't mean to do that, but take a hike. That sounds really bad. Take a hike. Tomorrow it's going to be 57 degrees, one of the nicest days of the winter. And you know it's going to get down to 20 again one of these days. So tomorrow, take a friend on a hike. Go and talk, even if it's 20 minutes. But get out there with someone and talk to them. And then another challenge, take someone, take them aside and pray with them. Take time to pray with a friend and ask how they're doing spiritually. Maybe someone really needs some encouragement. Who do you need to encourage this week? Let's pray. Dear Lord, well, I hope we're really encouraged, even in the midst of the gut punches today. We need our friends. And if anything, help us just to be so thankful for our church family and our friends. When we feel alone, help us to realize there are people that really do care for us. And when we're hurting, we can reach out to others to help us in this journey. We need each other. So challenge us. Help us to think of someone who really needs us this week. And we just need to take that extra effort to reach out to them and be their friend. Thank you for this challenge from your word today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand together and sing.
Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Teach my song. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. You're my one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. My one defense, my one defense, my righteousness, oh God.
Every hour, and our friends need him every hour, and I've heard it said that the way that people can see Christ on earth is through his body. That's us, right? That's believers. So one of the follow-up questions that you'll find on our website is this: how can I pray for my friends and support them spiritually? Now, what's the best way to know how to pray for somebody? Ask them. There we go. So that's your challenge. Ask somebody how you can pray for them. I don't think there's a better way to get a glimpse into how somebody's doing, what's going on in their life, than just simply asking, how can I pray for you? Most people won't reject that. Most people won't say, no. Or if they do and you have a good enough friendship, dig a little bit deeper. So do that this week. Pastor Brandt, like he said, we have extra time here this morning. Maybe even ask a friend this morning, how can I pray for you? How can I support you? Call or text somebody this week and ask how you can pray for them. That's your challenge for this week. And there's a couple other follow-up questions on the website. Thanks for joining us. You're dismissed.